Welcome, everybody, to the Fantasy Golf Insider webcast and podcast. I'm Jeff Bergerson, joined, as always, by my partner, Zachary Turcotte. We're with FantasyGolfInsider.com, your number one resource for everything fantasy golf and DFS golf. Come check us out today, and if you are not a premium member, go ahead and sign up. This broadcast is available in podcast form on iTunes and Stitcher, so you can check us out there as well. Be sure to give us a good review. Also, subscribe to our YouTube channel so you know exactly when this webcast comes out each and every week. Zachary, no PGA DFS last week with the Zurich Classic, but there was Euro Tour going on.
Definitely.
And yeah. I think our members realized or discovered just how well we cover Euro Tour with David and mine and Perry's articles and Eric's model. We absolutely crushed it last week in Euro. A lot of big wins to show for it. I heard from a few people. Ron Melanson said he used the Euro lineup generator, produced 15 teams, and had a team finish sixth in the birdie contest. So that's pretty awesome. Chris Hunyadi won the Euro Quarter Arcade. And Josh Schaefer, JD Trade 22, said he'd never played Euro before, but he bought our Euro Tour package 5 days before the event and took second in the $333 contest on DraftKings.
Just grabbing guys who were in the top 15 our model to make his team. So
it's good stuff. So folks, if you haven't tried Euro Golf, go ahead and try it. Give our premium package a chance. Or you could just add the Pro Pack, go to the Pro Pack and get the Euro Tour as well.
It's getting to the point of the year where the events get to be a little more predictable too. So it's a good time to get in. You know, the last couple months we've seen the tour over in China and in India and all parts of the world, which tends to attract a lot more of the local players.
Local, right.
You won't necessarily have heard of a lot of the guys that are out there, but now we're getting back to the continent, actual Europe for the European tour for the most part over the next few months. And so I think you'll start to see some stronger fields out there as well.
I was a little bit disappointed. I had a huge share in Fratelli and I thought he was going to do it. And he really choked on Sunday, be honest.
Yeah, that was
if
rough.
He could have won it, I would have cashed big. Instead, I just cashed a little bit. So
yep, we were on him too for the big contest. Yep.
But there was also an event at the Zurich. It was a team event. I'm going to be honest. I watched about an hour of it,
the entire
event. It shows you just how big of an impact DFS has. And I really didn't feel like I could really glean a lot from the event. Like, I wasn't going to learn a whole lot just because the format was so different.
Yeah, a lot of the big all-star teams that people were excited about didn't make the cut.
Right.
So,
which we kind of talked about. We thought that might happen.
Thought that could definitely be something that would happen because the guys would just be excited to show up and play with another big name out there. And it doesn't always necessarily push them to play a better game overall.
And the format isn't conducive for star dominance either.
Right.
And we saw that.
Yeah. And I mean, it's the frustrating part is a few of the guys who are right up there at the top are guys that we've been very much on.
Cam Smith in my crystal ball article. I have been on him in my core almost, I think, probably every event he's played.
So are we going to count that? I think we can kind of count that sort of as another
I think
hit
definitely.
For the crystal ball.
Yeah, maybe. Another hit, but I didn't.
I know.
Neither did our members.
Kevin Kisner is a guy who we were on
all the time
this season. And so he was right there as well. So it was a little bit frustrating to see those guys right there that we've been riding all season long that finally do something really good and it doesn't...
kind of blows the cover, too.
Well, and that's the thing, because the week before, we'd been on Cam Smith as well.
Oh, yeah.
Pretty hard, especially in some of the bigger contests that you and I had played lineups in for the week.
Yep.
And so when he had been up in first place the week before, I thought, well, next week will probably be the week that, he just lights it up and goes off and we can't really do anything about it.
Right.
And so, yeah, I mean, I think it was a okay event. I mean, if you were a fan of... the tour and wanted to see something a little different. You got to see some of these teams sort of gelled a little bit. The Texas team with Spieth and Palmer obviously showed up and they did pretty well. But for the most part, I don't know that it would attract me back next season as something I would be all that excited to to watch.
Yeah, we put the poll out on Twitter to see what people thought of it and who watched it as much or not as much. And it was pretty overwhelming. About 80% of people watched it much less than a normal event, which is kind of stands to reason. I wasn't surprised by that because most of our audience is DFS related. But I just wonder what impact it has on, you know, the game itself.
I was hoping we get to watch a little bit more of the Volvo China Open last week.
Would be nice, wouldn't
but
it?
But somehow, for whatever reason, the Golf Channel just decided to show almost none of the event live at any point, which was completely strange to me. I have no idea what was going on or what that was all about, but I kept thinking, oh, 7 o'clock on Thursday, Friday night, 8 o'clock, perfect time to get some live golf on. 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning, I'm home after being out Saturday night. Let's flip on it. Oh, wait, it's broadcasting the LPG event from earlier in the day or the Zurich from
again
earlier in the day. So it just still confuses me. It doesn't make a lot of sense. I'm not sure what the rationale would be at 2 in the morning if you have the opportunity as the Golf Channel to show live coverage. I don't know why you would ever not take advantage of that, but you know, we'll keep pounding away to try to get our point across, just kind of knowing that it probably won't happen at any point in the near future.
True. One more item to note is that the Players' Championship is next week, big event, and I will actually not be on the webcast next week because I will be down in Florida. I'm going to go to the Players' Championship on Thursday, so anyone who's down there wants to meet up and grab a cocktail, walk the course, or just chat some golf, hit us up on Twitter or email. Better yet, if you have any free tickets, or best yet, if you have a luxury box overlooking a green or a suite of some sort and want to hook a guy up from FGI, then let me know. I'd be more than willing to hang there as well. So so let us know. Perry's going to fill in for me next week with Zachary. I'm looking forward to it. I've never been there, and it's one of those courses that TPC Sawgrass, one that I really want to see.
Very cool.
Let's talk about this week, shall we? We got DFS back, so
it's an interesting one. Yeah, headed to Wells Fargo, but not the typical Wells Fargo.
Not Quail event. Hollow this year. We're at Eagle Point Golf Club in North Carolina, so we're not looking at tournament history very closely. We can look at the database, look for some North Carolina guys, and see who's Simpson, from there. There's a few that jump out. Yeah, Simpson. Yep.
Both Carl.
Carl Peterson. Yeah. He's a member on the course. So Tom Fazio Design. It opened in 2000. Now, I've been reading a couple different sources. On the PGA website, it says 7,259 yards. I've also seen 7,400. So I'm not really sure where we're going to be at somewhere in that range. Bermuda greens. It's going to be interesting because we basically have zero tournament history, so it's tough to look at key stats that are going to matter. Our friends at Fantasy Golf Metrics say strokes gained tee to green, strokes gained putting, birdie or better, proximity, and par five scoring. So that's what we go with.
Perfect. Yeah, and I've heard a couple things. I've read a couple things that said it correlates a little bit with like Augusta National. So take that for what it's worth. It's going to be really hard to see until they actually are out there and playing for us to get a real good grip on how this thing is going to score.
It's unusual that a course has never had like a major tournament to even kind of look at or absolutely zero. Yeah. So we're going to go with current form and key stats with the high weightings this week. But when I first opened up the pricing, I was very happy because I saw DJ at the top. And he was at 13,000. So I'm like, oh, cool. That's cool. The pricing's going to be tighter this week.
You got a decision to make right
away. That's right. Yep. It makes it interesting. Then I saw John Rahm at 11,000. I'm like, oh, nice. So it's going to be nearly impossible to stack these two for people.
Yeah.
Really interesting. Then I scroll down a little bit further. I'm like, oh, wait a minute. Alex Norton was supposed to be in this field. Where the hell did he go? Did he withdraw? I'm scrolling down. Oh, I guess he's not in the field. So then I'm looking for a couple other names, like Graham McDowell and whoever else who I knew was in the field. No sign of him. Oh, wait, I didn't go down to the 6K range. I thought once I saw like DA points and guys like that in the 7K range, I was like, oh, yeah, I guess they're not in the field. But no, they are.
6,600. Yeah, that was a shock as I went through the list because I wasn't even really looking excited. I don't really have the field memorized as I go through. And then I'm scrolling down and I'm thinking, wait a minute. Now this is gonna be got to be the biggest discrepancy.
Oh yeah.
In odds versus pricing of the week and maybe of the month. you know, because with a guy like Norton, yeah, he hasn't played great over the last couple months on the U.S. side of
right,
things.
Right, absolutely not.
But at 6,600, if all he has to do is get through the cut, and you know that from what he has done over the last year, he does certainly have some upside. So
yeah.
I think he'll probably be a player who is very, very highly owned in that range this week.
It just makes it tough to fade him, though. Because yeah. he doesn't have to do a lot.
And
like
if you were worried about trying to find a way to roster DJ, well,
yeah,
there you go. Yeah, it's not going to be that difficult.
Top 15
anymore.
Guy in the world to go along with him.
Yeah, I mean, at that point, you really could put. And there's plenty of guys that were in the lower range this week. That frankly, I was a little bit surprised that they were quite as low as they were. So you know, although 13,000 is a high price to pay for DJ. You're not going to have any real issue getting him onto your roster because you're definitely going to be able to grab at least two, maybe even three guys in the lower range, and you're not going to even be that upset. I mean, if you grab Lowry, McDowell, and Norin along with DJ up at the top,
not so bad.
Your average salary for your last couple guys comes out probably around like 8,000 or so, and then you've got a team looking up and down where you say, well, where's the real weak spot
right.
here?
Oh, then you can plug in like Kisner or Berger and you're like, holy cow.
Right.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, yeah. Or Oosthuizen. Or AU100, who also looked fairly underpriced for where he was at. So any interest in Bud Colley up at 9,400?
I had a lot of interest in Bud
Colley. Until the price came
up. I know. Now not so much. But
he's been a guy who's been trending upward in the right direction.
Absolutely.
He's been playing well. And then I was like, 9,400?
Oh, little rich.
That's a lot of spend for a guy who hasn't accomplished quite as much as anybody who else is priced right around him up in that range.
Right. So we got DJ Rom, Mickelson, Adam Scott at 10,000, Paul Casey 9,900, Reed at 98, and Webb at 97.
Yeah, wow, that's tough. Yeah, I mean, if you're looking at cash games, I'm very interested in what people are going to do with DJ this weekend. At first, I thought at 13,000, ownership would be very low. And I still think overall, this is probably like a 13 to 15% kind of week for DJ. I think that people are probably still going to be nervous about the back injury.
Probably.
You know, how severe is this back injury that he's returning from? And then if you combine that with the fact that his price is really on the high side and people don't tend to pay, I mean, this is kind of the breaking point as far as what people are willing to pay for the top golfer. So I think 15%. Might be a decent spot overall to get in on DJ. Because if he goes out there and he's just his usual dominant self and runs away with it, you know, you're going to end up kicking yourself at a low ownership type of an opportunity. So I'll be taking a look at DJ at the top for GPPs, not so much probably for cash. I just don't think it's worth going that high for him. Or even for Rom at 11,000. That's too much. I think most of my picks will probably start out at around 10, looking at like Adam Scott. You know, Phil Mickelson's a little intriguing at 10-2, but his game is so up and down. He can be so erratic. I just don't think I can quite pay up. So I think Adam Scott's probably like the top guy that I start looking at in terms of cash games and GPP for that price.
How about Simpson at 9,700? Now, I read
he's a member
here
of the club,
as well as Quail Hollow.
Yeah.
We went large on him the last couple of years. A couple of years, it paid off nicely because he took a runner-up, but not so much last year.
We missed the cut.
Right.
Yeah, so that's a tough one,
especially at that price.
Yeah, and especially because he's been so up and down.
Way up and down, yeah.
But he looked pretty good the last time out when we saw him. And I think 9,700 by the middle of the week, everybody's going to know that he was a member at this course.
Right.
There's no real secrets in the DFS. But 2-3 years ago, that would have been a great piece of information where you would have known it and other people would not have, and you could have gotten a pretty good opportunity.
Yep.
So I'll probably own some shares. I don't know that an overweight will necessarily be in order for me.
Yeah, I'll probably be far underweight, I would guess.
Just given his form overall on the season, I can't count on him week to week.
Yep. Dropping down to the 8K range, Cam Smith, 8,500. That's frustrating. Kevin Kisner, 8,400. Daniel Berger at 8,300. I think all three of those guys will get a large amount of ownership this week.
Yeah, I mean, if I'm for me starting my cash games this week, it's going to start with Kisner and probably Oosthuizen. And those two guys have been very consistent throughout the season. You know, Kisner's a South Carolina guy, so he's pretty familiar overall with the area and with the style of course. So I think those are two very, very easy plays to line up with to start your cash games with for the week.
The 7K range is barely. Kind of the abyss.
Yeah,
I mean, look at some names like in the high seven, like Patton Kizzire at 7,800. That just is bizarre, and I have very little interest. Jim Furyk at 7,800.
Zach Blair at 76.
Scott Brown, 76. If I were to pick out a couple in that range, maybe JT Poston at 77.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I like him. But again, with this pricing structure, I don't love him so much at that price, considering what I can get in the 6K range, who I would consider just as good.
Yeah, I mean, I'll probably look at McGirt at 7,900, who's been very good this season, and then Poston at 77. Dropping down, I have a little bit of interest as well. Martin Laird, his stats a bit. When he's been good, he's been very good this season.
True.
And when he hasn't,
he's missed the cut.
Right. Yeah. So, but at 7,100, I think that's a nice price for him. You know, a lot of weeks when people are high on Laird, he's 8,300, 8,600. 7,100, that's a nice price. That's a cut maker's
price.
Not
for cash games. Cash games?
I'll be thinking about it. Okay. Consider, because cash, we are a little bit thin in terms of guys that I would say are just cash game locks. I mean, typically I'm able to find 15 to 17 guys that I really like in cash games, and out of those guys, 10 to 12, I'm very high on overall. This week, it's tricky. There are maybe 12 to 13 players this week that I would look at that I would feel really good about for cash overall. So Laird is probably borderline for the price, and depending on the type of team that I want to put forward and how heavily I want to weight some of the higher salaried players.
He will not be on my cash. <That's good. laughs> I will make that clear. He will not be. Then you got guys like Stroud at 7,300, Zach Johnson down in that 7K range. Yeah, his game is so
he's been miserable
so off
this year. Yeah, he just hasn't been himself. I mean, he would be one again. I wouldn't feel comfortable at all playing him in cash, but you know, definitely a
GPP. No one's going to own him.
Yeah, I mean, he's getting to the point where he's like a 5 to 7%
range. Yeah, I was going to say range. Single digits. Yeah,
so. If you're looking to take some chances on a couple of guys, he would be one of those guys that I think you would definitely want to consider at least.
Anyone else in this 7K range that interests you at all?
I mean, maybe Nick Taylor at 7,000.
Yeah, he's been playing real well.
He's in really good form, so I do like what we've seen there throughout most of the season, but nothing else there that I really liked.
Just to stress on, we touched on it earlier, the sportsbook odds versus pricing model. Be sure to check that out because we're seeing numbers that we hardly ever see before. So be sure to check that out because there's a couple guys in that 6K range that are like in the 50s and 60s.
Yeah, I think we probably touched on the ones we like enough. There's a handful of others that are down there. I mean, Stuart Sink, one of your favorites.
Oh, God, I hate that guy.
He's in the lower six. But he did bounce back. He missed the cut the 1 week at RBC, and then he bounced back with another top 25.
I know.
So, I mean, 6,400.
And he's high on that sportsbook odds.
It's a great price.
Ugh,
and then the last guy I'll mention is another Carolina native. It's Harold Varner III. Mm-hmm. I think this could be a great course for him. You know, down at 6,300. If it's a course where, you know, par five scoring is going to come into play, bigger hitters off the tee, he's definitely a guy who could make some noise. 6,300. He can be a little boom or bust, but he's been more on the boom side lately overall as far as making cuts. So that'll be the last guy that I give away down in that range.
That's it, huh?
Oh, we've already talked
about it. And especially Thursday, Friday on FanDuel. For Varner, oh my God!
Oh yeah, yeah,
so
yeah.
So cash money the first 2 rounds.
Just plug him in for the first 2 rounds.
Well, I haven't seen the FanDuel pricing yet because I don't know is it even out yet. It was like 5 o'clock and it wasn't out. They're not. I don't know.
I think they're scrambling over there a little bit.
Couldn't possibly get it out in time, so you don't want any interest coming out early on Monday, right?
Well, I mean, there were 4 whole guys left to play today, so
I'm sure that might affect the odds dramatically.
Threw everything way, way off.
Let's talk a little bit about weekend golf.
Yes. All right. Yeah.
All right.
You having good success with that so far?
I have been having pretty good success.
I think we've been on to something as far as what we came up with. You know, looking at it that first couple of weeks, we really had to redesign what the model was going to tell us for Saturday, Sunday, because you can't just reweight a couple of different statistics for, you know, the 70 guys or so who are left in the field. You have to kind of figure out where guys are in terms of their position for the event and where they would be anticipated to end up. And that's something that the model has done a great job of pointing out for us. Because when you see a player like Matt Kuchar, who's 66 going into the weekend, but you know he was one of the favorites coming in, well, that doesn't necessarily mean he's going to rise to the top.
No.
More often than not, from what we know of Matt Kuchar,
right,
how well that he plays, he's probably not going to stay near the bottom.
Right.
So those are the types of things that we're looking for, and they're not always going to be quite that obvious, but we've been able to find a few things in terms of how we've built the model and in terms of the odds and the way that we've been able to track those that, we've had great success so far. And some people say, well, what about, you know, can you do cash games or just, you know, kind of stick to GPPs? I actually think cash games are the easiest way to win there.
I think so too.
Because for the most part, people still really haven't caught on to a strategy.
No.
I haven't seen any other models that are out there that are showing some of the stuff that we're seeing, so that a large majority of the teams that I put forward each week are in the top half of the field. Now, it gets tricky because it's going to come down to one guy with having a handful more birdies than somebody else,
right,
or somebody who pops out an eagle, or... because it's much, much tighter in terms of the spread. There's
it
no
is.
Points in terms of where they finish overall in the standings. So it can be just, you know, 5-10 points can be the difference between 1,000 places overall in the
true.
Standings.
Yep.
You know, so from that perspective, I would say, you know, jump on it for cash games overall. And you can pretty much use the same line. I would say you can use basically the same lineups in cash and in GPP.
Probably,
For the weekend golf.
I think that's true, but we saw a good example this past weekend with a guy like Ross Fisher on the Euro Tour.
Yeah.
That's like a perfect example of a guy who's kind of not played
barely
so well,
cut,
barely
right.
made the cut. The first two rounds was, you know, let a lot of people down on their normal week teams, but you got to think, hey, this guy, the odds are that he's going to make a run, and he sure did.
Hole in one and an eagle in the third round.
So huge. You would have easily won your cash games for you almost single-handedly.
Oh,
so
for sure, yeah.
That's a perfect example, and especially at his price, too, because he was high-priced, and people were like, you know, not playing well this week, but that's not necessarily the case. So anything else to add, Zachary, before we wrap up?
No, nothing. No Euro this week for
no
golf.
DFS.
So if you got all excited and had your fill last week, the... won't be anything this week, but again, next week it gets back onto a pretty regular schedule again, and they start working their way through the continent. So
and the big guys are going to be playing in a lot of those events.
It should be a little easier too, time wise, because I mean, when you're in China and India, it's like the start times get a little weird. Now the start times will be pretty consistent
each
Wednesday night at like 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock.
What time did it start last week? It was like
six p.m. 5:30 to 6 p.m. kind of time range.
Yep.
So yeah.
All right. Well, let us know if you're going to be down in Florida at the Players' Championship. Love to hook up with you. Zachary will do Periscope this week on Wednesday night for the Wells Fargo. If you have any questions, be sure to email us at info@fantasygolfinsider.com. Otherwise, best of luck this week for the Wells Fargo. We'll talk to you soon, and see you at the Players.
Good luck.